Good evening. Good evening. Good evening, HPU Chapel and friends. There's many friends in the congregation tonight. Welcome to worship. Welcome, university singers, and thank you to all musicians who'll be offering your gifts tonight. We're thankful for your ministry. I hope everybody's having a good week and enjoying this pre-spring weather. Tonight, we continue our worship series called Look Again, where we're encouraged to look beyond the surface of what we think we know about familiar and new scriptures to find what God is trying to say to us beneath the surface. Tonight, we'll spend some time in the book of Genesis, in the story of Abraham and Isaac, as they head to Mount Moriah, where God asks Abraham to sacrifice his only son. So I hope tonight in worship, it'll help you begin to ponder your calling. What is God calling you to sacrifice along the way of this calling? And my hope for you is that as we leave worship tonight and as we ponder these things, that we can give ourselves permission to be at peace with our humanity and its limitations so that we can truly co-create with God. So since we're thinking about that, I want to invite you to relax into your chairs and start taking some easy breaths. And we'll take the first deep breath right here, breathing in and breathing out. Again, breathing in, breathing out. One more time, breathing in and breathing out. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for the gift of your presence and for your love that carries us through peaks and valleys. We thank you for the gift of worship and that we can give you praise and be held by you. God, we just want to say thank you. And those who are willing have come ready tonight to receive what you've created just for them. And whatever that is, may it be so. We ask all of these things and say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, University Singers, for that beautiful piece. My name is Carly Zimmerman, and I am a senior here and the philanthropy chair for the Board of Stewards. So today I'll share a little bit about what we have going on for the Board of Stewards. We are partnering this semester with West End Ministries. West End Ministries' mission is to serve and work with the High Point community to make the West End and greater High Point area a better place. They have many different programs to help people in need in our community. We have a goal this semester of raising $10,000, and we're about halfway to that goal. So in order to raise the other half, we are hosting a 5K running event where you can run or walk the 5K, and this will be held on the High Point Greenway. As you can see on the flyer behind me, it shows the time and date, and you can check our socials for updates on this and how you can attend. It'll be a certain fee to attend and to run or walk the 5K, and we will also allow sponsors so that your friends and family can get involved and sponsor you as an athlete. Thank you so much.
Hi, friends. Over the last couple days, High Point University has been bringing in some young alumni to meet with students, to meet with young professionals. One of those folks who's come in is Michael Esposito. Say, hey, Michael Esposito.
Hey, Michael.
That was lovely of you. Michael graduated in 2017, and chapel was pretty transformative for him, and he asked if he could come during this time and say a couple of words. Can you give a warm HPU chapel welcome to Michael?
Hello, everyone. I'm Michael, as Preston just introduced me here. But it is very special to be back with you all here at chapel on this Wednesday afternoon, same time as it's always been. But as Preston mentioned, I've been back through the university, and I've had a chance to meet with HPU students of all years, and it's been really really special to hear from them and be able to share some advice as an early recent grad, I should say, and I've really enjoyed that opportunity to do so. And in talking to a lot of the freshmen, the sophomores, the juniors, I've really been reminded of how busy the college life really is. I was talking to students who are running in between meetings with different clubs, intramural sports, studying, getting papers done, and it is just it was a reminder of how busy this point in your life really is, and how dedicated your time is to everything that you're involved in and have going on. And it made me think about how busy I always was when I was in college and when I was here as a student. It made me think, especially being here back at chapel today, here with you, what an important piece of my time here in college coming to chapel was. Because just amid the hustle and the bustle, chapel is a place that you can come to take a moment to reflect and to find peace for just a moment in the middle of your day, in the middle of your week. But to connect with one another, yourself, and with God, most importantly. And so I am very happy to be back here and to see so many faces attending chapel on a Wednesday night and taking that time out of your busy week, your busy schedules to reconnect with yourselves and with God. So thank you all so much for the opportunity to be here with you today, and God bless. Thank you.
Thank you. Please stand and worship with us.
Never be more loved than I am right now. Was it holding you up? So there's nothing I can do to let you down. Doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Going through a storm, but I won't. An ocean, so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now. 'Cause you are Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough. So I will be content in every
love you. How much more does he love you?
much more?
How much more will he throw?
How much more?
How much more will he
if he watches
if
over
he
us?
Every
sparrow.
How much more?
Oh, if he dresses the
lilies
with beauty and splendor, how much more? God is provider. So don't you worry. No, don't you worry.
Every sparrow. How much more does he love?
How much
more?
Jireh.
Good evening. I now invite you all to pass the peace of Christ.
Would you all bow your heads and pray with me? Dear Father, I thank you for this day, Lord. This beautiful day that we could see your majesty present on this beautiful campus that we get to go to, Lord. Most importantly, I thank you for your son's death on the cross, Lord. His sacrifice, a death that he did not deserve, Lord. But now that we can, if we place faith in you, Lord, we can have forgiveness of our sins, Lord. And we can live for with eternity with you, Lord. And what a blessing that is. So I thank you for that, Lord. I pray for this service, Lord, that your word would saturate in our hearts and that we could be transformed because of it. And let us pray as you have taught us to. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hi, everybody. I will be reading from Genesis 22, verses 1 through 14. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. He said, Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of those mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. And the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, Father, and he said, Here I am, my son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. And the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. he bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its thorns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided."
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Me, Alma.
Good evening.
Almost knocked over your guitar, man. So I was talking to Michael before the service, and I promised him that we'd be done on time because he has to get back to Charlotte to watch Love is Blind on Netflix. And so a few others. Okay, he's not alone. You thought that was in pastoral confidence, didn't you? Yeah. Look at this. His girlfriend, who's an HPU grad as well, they're watching that together. Be careful who you meet in chapel. Like, it's really important. When thinking of that, I got to thinking about this scripture that we're diving into tonight, and this is like scripture that's almost too hot to get near. It's just so powerful and difficult to get into, and that's why we're doing this series. But instead of Love is Blind, it made me think about how we see. It was a little bit later than this last year. I went to go see my optometrist, and I've told this to you, some of you, before. And I've been seeing this optometrist for about 10 years, and so they were doing the thing. Do you know the thing, Aaron? Like, they get one, two, you know the thing? You know the thing, too? One, two. I don't know why they do this, Jack. Two's always better, right? Two's always better than one. Yeah, I don't know, like, don't show me. Just go ahead and show me two. Give me three. Can I see three? Like, what would three look like? I asked my optometrist, "You've been seeing me for 10 years now. Can you show me where I began 10 years ago? And where I am now?" It was so much fun. Try this next time you see your doctor. It's great. I couldn't see anything out of whatever -4 was, whatever it was before. But 2 was crystal clear. This passage, I think that might help us in this way. This passage, this scripture, is asking us to take a second look. It's asking us to move from a kind of stage 1 faith to a stage 2 kind of faith. Or to see a new way, or see through new eyes. Or to have our hearts changed in such a way that we see the world in a different way. And you got to do that. Because you don't see the world as it is. You see the world as you are. And God is always trying to get inside your world, break inside your little life, and change the way you see. You don't see the way the world is. You see the world the way you are. You got to go from 1 to 2. Here's on the face of it. Let's go back through the scripture again and just look at it with the ways. There's all these images, things that come out with sight, how you might see. That passage is asking us to see better. God comes and tests Abraham. We're going to talk about that in a second. And Abraham says, "Here I am." It's the claim of the prophets always in the Hebrew Bible. "Here I am." God says, "Take your son, your only son, the one you love, the land of Moriah, and I will show you a mountain." And Abraham goes and finds a place that God shows him in verse 3. In verse 4, on the third day — day 3s are always important in the Bible, aren't they? Day 3, Abraham looks up and sees a place far away. And then Abraham says to those he's taken with him — did you catch this? It's really important when you read this passage — those who's taken with him to help, he says, "Stay here. The boy and I will go worship. And then we will return." Not "I will return," "we will return." He thinks there's more to see here. He walks up the mountain. He's about to bring — and then Isaac says, as they're going up the mountain, he says, "Father, where's the lamb for the offering?" is another way of saying, "I don't see what I would hope to see." And Abraham says, "The Lord will provide," or another way of saying that is, "I see something you don't see, Isaac." The dramatic act happens. Isaac's on the altar. The knife is raised, as the story says. And then the angel says, "Stop!" And then Abraham looks up again, it says, and he sees a ram in the thicket. And then he says this. You got to sing it, and it's so powerful the way that you got to sing it tonight from Collision's leadership. They calls the place Jehovah Jireh. Say Jireh. It means the Lord will provide, but it also means the Lord shall be seen. The Lord shall be seen. As if once you've seen that the Lord will provide, that the Lord is merciful, that the Lord is generous, the Lord watches over every sparrow, how much more will he clothe you, that the Lord will abide with you. You can't unsee this God. It stays with you. So if we have a little boldness tonight, let's look at this story through the eyes of Abraham maybe for a moment. If we have even more boldness, let's look at it through the eyes of Isaac. And then I hope you see what the early Israelites, Hebrew writers of this text are trying to get you to see in this God that you can't unsee once you've taken a second look. Now, those of you who've been around HPU Chapel for a while know that I've talked about all these tests that are in the Bible. There's tons of tests that happen in the Bible. Are tests fun? I'm so glad no one in here went like, yeah, that would have been really strange. Are tests fun? Are tests necessary? Oh, that was a deep nod. Like the nod in the back was like, Unfortunately, yes. The way I think about it, Michael and I became friends here when something terrible happened on this campus. And he came to this place looking for people who were tested. He came looking for this place people who had been through the ringer. Unfortunately, he got a young chaplain who didn't know what he was doing. But that's what he was looking for. When you go to get advice from somebody, do you want an untested person? No. You want somebody who's weathered but wise. You want people who show you the way, who mentor you, who know a little bit more, who see a little bit more, who've got a little more years on them. Maybe they limp, but they limp with a little more love in their life. No, tests are not fun, but we want to be tested people. I've said this before, I'll say it again, this terrible movie, great scene in the movie, Evan Almighty. Have you seen Evan Almighty? No? Okay, best scene in the movie, here it is, you ready? Evan Almighty, there's a scene where the wife of Evan Almighty, she's at wit's end, and she comes and is talking to this guy. She doesn't know it's God. It's Morgan Freeman. How did she not know it was God? It was Morgan Freeman. And she ends up talking to Morgan Freeman, and she's trying to understand. Like, she says, you know, I've just been praying to God. I've been praying that things would get better. I've been praying that our family would love each other better. And it's just not happening that way. And Morgan's like, hey, whoa, hold up. Let's say you pray to become a more peaceful person or more patient person. Do you think God just makes you a more patient person, or does God give you the opportunities to become more patient? So say you want to be a courageous person. Do you think God just sort of puts that in you and says, now be courageous? Do you think God puts you in positions, unfortunately, that feel like tests, where you have to become more courageous? He looks at her and says, say you want your family to love each other more than you do right now. Do you think God just zaps warm and fuzzies into them? Or does God give you the chance to practice being a more loving people? You see? One or two. Always two. God's always putting us in a kind of place that we might become more whole, might become more mature. We might be tested. But in becoming tested people, we become more of that deep reflection of who God is in the world, moving through the world in mercy, a God who provides. And when you see this God, you can't unsee this God. He breaks into your little world and begins to expand your own heart. You might see the world and yourself differently. This is what Abraham's into. It's how he sees it. Now, some of you are saying, that's great, Preston. That's wonderful. Tests, good. But the subject matter of this test in this story is his son. There's more parents in the room tonight than there usually are. They get this. this is not a fair test. This is a test no one can endure. What kind of test is this? Even more important, what kind of God would ask such a thing? Isaac, we've got to be thinking about where we place ourselves in the text. We always do this. We might place ourselves as Abraham. Maybe we feel like we're tested, but like, I wonder if we might for a moment place ourselves in Isaac's shoes. Isaac's fascinating here. He doesn't say a lot in the Bible. This is one of the one things he says when he says, God, or he says to his father, I don't see a ram. Where's the offering? Isaac, he gets laid on this altar, and you got to just think about the fear and quaking. I know you come to chapel to get esoteric knowledge, so I'll provide you some. Alice Miller, who was a psychiatrist in the late 20th century, she wrote books called The Drama of the Gifted Child and The Untouched Key, and she got super famous. And the main key to her books was saying that essentially most of the baggage that you and I carry in life is developed when we're kids, and we're just sorting it out constantly. Our parents tried to love us well. They may have given us all they got, but somehow it just gets mixed up. We're sinful, ridden with sin kind of people, and always we turn in on ourselves and we can't unpackage it so well. And sometimes if we don't do something with that, we then turn that burden on other people. And she says that it's passages like this that could even be to blame. Says that there's such a population of people in the world who think they have to have blind faith. And she references this Rembrandt story. Check out this image. This is Rembrandt's painting of this story. It's devastating. Where there's a bunch of us who feel like we're Isaacs in the world, where someone's covered up our eyes and they're coming down with a dagger. Is this how this story is meant to be read? A kind of blind faith that will do anything for God. I think we got to take this critique seriously. I love what the Rabbi Jonathan Sacks says about the Bible, and this is why we're doing this series. On something like this, to look again. He says, the Bible is a beautiful thing, and it requires a lot of responsibility from us. He says, when you read Scripture, pay attention to your sympathies, Cody. When you read Scripture, pay attention to where your heart goes. Because God is smart enough, the Bible is smart enough to know that it wants a relationship with you. And if it wants a relationship with you, it means it's having a conversation with you. And so it's asking you, how are you going to read this story? Are you going to read it on a kind of flat level? Or can you read it in a deeper way? One or two? It's asking you to go a little deeper into the text. Pay attention to your sympathies. Where do your sympathies cry out in this story? Oh God, don't they cry out for Isaac? I know this because y'all have shared this with me. Many of you. Back in that back room. And we talked. Several years ago, way before y'all's time, it was actually around Michael's time here at school, there's this young woman, it was about end of the school year, she came and visited me, and she didn't call herself Isaac, but every detail of her life proclaimed it in a kind of way. She said, I don't know how my parents intend for me to become whole. My mom chose my major for me. My mom counts my calories. My mom picks out my clothing. My mom determined what sorority she wanted me in. I don't know how they want me to become whole when they keep cutting me in half, her words. I think a lot of us in the room know the feeling of what it is to be an Isaac, to feel like we're on the altar of our own lives and not getting to live as God has called us to live because someone is maybe holding us down in a way. Here's the profound part of this story that I want you to catch. The early Israelites, when they're writing this story, the Hebrew people, when they're writing this story, they are writing it, they are finishing it in exile. What is exile? Exile is when they have been captured by empire after empire, running through the small sliver of Eastern Asia, from the Assyrians to the Egyptians to the Babylonians to the Romans. And when they're in exile in Babylon, they begin to put the finishing touches on this story. They begin to speak of a God who's with them even in the midst of disaster. A God who's with them even as they feel like they are on the altars of history to be sacrificed. It is a wild faith they have. They feel like they're on the altars of history to be sacrificed, And their faith says, no, God won't do it. God won't do that to us. That's not the God we worship. You've got words like this in 2 Corinthians. We've been pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. We carry the death of Christ Jesus in us that we might have his life in us. It's a wild faith. If not that, if them, why not you? Even as you feel like you might be an Isaac. If them, why not you? See, this story, this isn't a God won't give you more than you can handle. Logan, this is a God won't give you more than God can handle. One or two? You want the second one. The first one's nothing but a kind of cliche for your own self-worship using God language. No. We want a better God. And that's what the scripture is introducing to us. Can I push it a little further? Oh, it gets better. It gets better. So the terrible scene, and it's Abraham's got Isaac on the altar. And this is where the people of Israel, they've placed themselves there. They feel like they're on the altar. They feel like they might lose it, but they have faith. God's not going to do that to them. And then as Abraham's about to bring the knife down, the angel says, stop. No, don't do it. And then Abraham calls the place Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. Or in another Hebrew translation, it's so lovely. The Lord will be seen. The Lord will be merciful. The Lord will be generous. The Lord will be compassionate. And when you've seen that kind of God for who that God is, you can't unsee that God. They're saying that, like, this is the most powerful thing in the universe. Not the armies that have run over us, but a depth of compassion that still runs through this world that will not be crushed. And if it's crushed, it will rise again. It can't be buried in the ground. It's going to come out. And it lives in us. Here's why this is so cool. It might be confusing for this kind of passage, this kind of story to be in the Bible for you. It's not perplexing for me now after years of studying and having great teachers like Al Ward. See, like, this is an early ancient kind of religion. Why is that important? Because ancient religion, there's tons of child sacrifice. Why? Like, this is the way they understand how the world works. Why? Like, well, you're dealing with unseen forces. Like, you plant stuff in the ground, and, like, rain waters it, sun shines on it, and all of a sudden, miracle, boom, you got stuff coming out of the ground. You got a harvest. And you sacrifice something to God, maybe some of that grain, maybe some of the slaughter, something like that. But what happens when the rains don't come? Like, what happens when the crop, the harvest, doesn't happen? It's kind of a desperation that takes place. Oh, you got to sacrifice a little more. You got to sacrifice maybe something that's deeply precious to you. Here's what's so powerful about this story. It's as if God says, I've heard that story before. That's not how the story goes. It's like that story is played out through Babylonian culture, Assyrian culture, all sorts of Canaanite cultures. But the Hebrew people, they say, we've heard that story. God interrupts it and says, no, that's not how the story goes anymore. They want to introduce you to a better God. They want to introduce the people before them to a better God. And not just to a better God, but to a God who is better. And the same goes for you today. This Lord will be seen. And when you see this God, he can't be unseen. He begins to reshape the inner parts of your life. And you begin to see the world in a new way. When we were on the pilgrimage to Greece, it was absolutely wonderful. Dog tired the whole time. Waking up at 2 a.m. when I came back home. I know some of you were doing the same. We would have these days where, like, you got to understand, like, the early church that moved from Jerusalem all the way over to Greece into Europe, like, they were meeting in houses. They were meeting, like, in the streets. Like, so they didn't have any temples. But if you go to these places in Greece, there's all these temples. But they're to, like, figures like Zeus and Athena and Nike. I was like, that's really interesting. Like, and, like, the earliest Christians, they were called atheists because they didn't believe in these gods. So we would end every day with discussion. We're in an everyday of like what we're trying to wrap our minds around what we've seen in these temples and these places. And most of us, like, we would say things like, I can't believe people would believe in, like, gods like that. And then one night, somebody on the pilgrimage, probably the wisest person on the trip, doesn't talk very much, just said, I don't know. I kind of get it. And we're like, what do you mean? We thought, you can't say something like that. He said, well, I kind of get it. Like, I mean, Nike's just the god of victory. What is that but winning? What is that but success? I could see folks worshiping that. Or like, what is Athena but the god of war? I don't know. I think I could see some people worshiping that. Now, who is Zeus but might itself? The kind of will to power to do whatever you want? I don't know. I can see how they would worship them. I don't see how they could worship. I could see how we still worship those things. And along comes these Hebrew people with a wild faith and a God who's compassion itself and a God who's mercy itself and a God who interrupts the story and says, there's a better one. These aren't gods we worshiped a long time ago, are they, friends? They're still the gods we worship today, day in, day out. And along comes the people who want to write to us and say, what are those gods doing to you? How's that working out for you? Worshiping those kind of things. It's as if God still wants to interrupt our stories today, break into our stories today, and show us the one who we're always supposed to be worshiping. One or two. We always want to. For those of us who feel so compelled, and we see this story coming true, and we see this God, it makes so much sense to us. It's almost like we hear the angel cry out and say, Abraham, stop. We could just replace our name and put it there. Preston, stop. Jim, stop. Dom, stop. Any of us. Gabe, stop. There's a better God to be worshipped here. There's one who knows your name. For those of us who feel so compelled by Jesus, is this one. We look at him, and it's like one or two, and he's the two. And we feel so compelled because we hear him saying, follow me. And if he says, follow me, it means don't just praise resurrection. It means practice it. It doesn't just look like looking for the kingdom of God in the world. It means saying, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's Jesus saying, don't just praise me. Follow me. One or two. Take a look again. It's always two. Y'all pray with me? Gracious God, you're always breaking into this world to write a better story, a new story. One that interrupts how we thought of who you were before. And you're just the God that's way beyond how we imagined you. You're better than that. You're more active in the world than we imagined. And you're asking us to come alongside you so that when we see you, we can't unsee you. When we get you inside our hearts, changes the way we see everything. God, do that tonight to someone in this room. Break into their world so that they will never be the same again. We all need you. And all God's people said, amen.
We are really excited to share this piece with you. And first, we want to just share a little bit about it and a little bit about what we're doing and why. This piece is called The Prayer, and it's for anyone navigating the unknown, or crossroads, or your calling, anyone who is desiring God's presence. So as you listen to this song, we invite you into this secret place with God. Again, to make this your prayer or a prayer for someone else.
I translated the lyrics partially into Chinese, and I want to dedicate my version to God who brought us all here together today, and to all my dear mentors and friends who helped me through my journey here at HPU. I pray that God will always look after those of us who feel lost in our journey. I pray that we will always find the light that guides us through our difficulties. And I pray that we'll always be kind and curious to one another and give us faith so we'll be safe. And for more behind-the-scenes stories between me and Andrea and this piece, please stay tuned for the release of Infinite Space this year. Advertisement.
Just where we go, and help us to be kind in times where we don't know. Let this be our prayer when we lose our way.
Just like every child, 照亮我梦想，指引我方向。
Gracious God, indeed guide us to a place that's of your choosing, of your making, and where we don't have eyes to see you. Break into our world. Break into our lives. You might show us a better God. You might show us one who loves us infinitely and guides us into that better place. Take these, your children, out into the world. They may be your reflection of mercy and love. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And God will raise.